Welcome back to Let's Code. I'm Chris Biscardi, and today we're going to be talking about this rainbow sphere that has hexagons all over it, some alpha blending, and this pressure wave that starts at one end, goes around the sphere, and ends at the other. Now, I'm super happy with this. This is really exciting for me because I am on my way to developing a bunch of sort of energy shield barrier kind of shaders, and this is a huge step on the way to that for me. All right, so this code is going to be in the pressure wave sphere example in the Bevy examples repo. I'll link it down below in the description. We've got two shaders here. We've got a vertex shader for the displacement of the hexagons, and we've got a custom material fragment shader dealing with the colors. To start out with this, I used Blender to construct a sphere made of hexagons and a couple of pentagons, I think, are scattered around here. But basically, I made an icosphere. And then I subdivided that a bunch and made it a bunch of hexagons. So that's how we get this sort of sphere of hexagons. I probably could have built that inside of Bevy itself, but I wanted to start experimenting more with loading GLTF exports from Blender into Bevy. So this is a GLTF file that I've loaded into Bevy and then replaced the material on. So if we go into main.rs, it starts to look kind of familiar to the other videos that I've done on shaders. We've got the default plugins. We've got a clear color, which is the blue in the background. We've got this shader utils, which provides all of the noise functions that I use in these shaders. That's in this repo as well, although I do need to update it. We add our custom material. Our custom material is our own struct. We have a setup system, a change color system, and a mod scene system. The change color system, as you can see, is horribly named because this is a, if I make this a little bigger, you can see that the change color system is actually a time update system. So horrible name. I need to change that, which leaves us with setup and mod scene. Setup in Bevy 0.8, we get these scene bundles, which is really cool because we get to load in GLTF files, or GLB in this case. The GLB file is just a binary format for GLTF. So they're basically the same thing, except one is production optimized and one is development optimized. When we bring in the GLTF file Blender export, we need to specify what we're going to render. So in this case, I'm rendering scene zero. The whole scene is just a one sphere at the 0, 0 point inside of the file. So, you know, there's not much going on here. There's nothing really else to select. And then I'm inserting this GLTF scene component, which I don't think I actually use. I was using it for some debugging at some point, but we could actually just delete that. And then obviously we need a camera looking at this sphere, because if there's no camera looking at the sphere, then we can't see it. And you know, the whole thing is pointless. We've got our custom material implementation right here that points to the custom material fragment shader and the vertex shader, which is just called vertex shader. Man, I should really come up with some standardized names for these. We do have an alpha mode here. So you see in the example here on the left, the colors look like they're kind of blending with colors from the background. That's because of the alpha mode. So we can set alpha on each of these colors and they can blend with the other side of the sphere and anything behind them. There's nothing behind them in this case, except for, you know, empty void. But if there was, it could. We do implement the specialized function here, which allows us to specialize the pipeline a little bit. In this case, we use it to specify the cull mode for the mesh. So the mesh on this sphere, we don't want to cull the back faces. So I've set that to none. So we do no culling for any of the vertices. And then I've also set an optional label in case anything goes wrong and it has to spit out an error at us. In this case, I've called it shield underscore because that was the original name of this project. We've got our asbind group, which takes time and a color texture or an optional color texture and an alpha mode. I don't think I'm using the color texture at all, but I was playing with it at one point. Yeah, so we don't have a color texture in the current iteration of it, but I could pass something in here and then it would get mapped to this sphere. Mod scene is where the interesting bits happen. So mod scene is where we query for the inserted, or query for the scene, basically the GLTF scene that we loaded and inserted as a scene bundle. In this case, we query for the entity that has a mesh on it, or a handle to a mesh, and a name. The GLTF scene objects have names, so if we wanted to, we could name them in Blender, bring them in here, and then actually like filter or match on the names. If we look at the GLTF file, we can see the name here is just icosphere because I was unoriginal and I didn't know what was going to happen. So it's named Icosphere Forever. So this name would be Icosphere if we wanted to match on it, or like if we had multiple entities in the scene and we only wanted to swap out the material for one of them. Then we've got our meshes, we've got our custom materials, just like our other shaders. And the query for the meshes is called spheres. So we insert this component, this inserted component, after we process it. So this system always runs, and whenever the scene gets inserted, we query constantly for these new meshes. And whenever we see one, we add this inserted component, and then we don't process it again. So we pluck out the mesh that we find inside of the scene. In this case, there's one scene and one mesh. So, you know, we're not filtering much here. We're just grabbing it. Just like we've done before on this mesh, we can also grab the VEC3, which are float 32s. So there's three F32s in a VEC, and these represent the vertex attribute values. So in this case, it's the position of each of the vertices for each of the hexagons. We grab those and we set them up with some colors. We've done this before. We're just directly translating the position to colors. I like to do this for debugging purposes. So if I turn off all of my custom coloring and things like that, or I turn off my shader, then I see very obviously that I have turned off the shader and that the colors have changed. And we insert that attribute back on the mesh. So all of the things that we do in this respect for meshes that we create inside of Bevy with the shape module, we can also do with GLTF, which is really nice. Then we add one of our custom materials to the custom materials asset database. We set the color to blue, which I don't even think I use in this case. We set the alpha mode to blend, which we do use. And we set the time, which gets overridden anyway. I don't know that this is the best way to replace things, but it works. So we grab the entity, so that is the sphere. We remove the standard material that is on it, because every GLTF object that comes in a scene gets a standard material applied to it. In this case, we want our custom material to be applied to it. So we remove the standard material handle and we insert our custom material handle. And that's it. We're just applying our material to the object in the GLTF scene. That's it. And you know, there's better ways to do this, because there is a bug where if I stop this and start it again, sometimes the time doesn't get updated. So definitely this is a buggy approach, but it works for me for now. Now all of that data gets sent into the vertex shader first. Most of this is the default vertex shader, except for this section here. So if you go into the Bevy repo and you find the default vertex shader, this is the default vertex shader. I add nothing up until we're into the vertex function, in which case I have this code right here, which handles the pressure wave. And then all the rest down here is also just straight copied from the default vertex shader. So let's take a look at this function, because these are very long and I did not put them on new lines, apparently. That's unfortunate. So we've got this function here. This function is basically taking a sine wave like we did in the candy cane example, or the candy cane shader. So if you didn't watch the candy cane shader, go watch the candy cane shader if you're interested in what this sine wave is doing. Basically, we set the frequency, we pass in the time as the x value. I'm also passing in the vertex.position.y and vertex.position.z, although this y and z controls the position of the start point of the pressure wave that comes around the sphere. So we could change that to whatever we want. There's a couple of variables here. There's the thickness of the sphere. There's how long to stay in the extended state. So we're bringing these vertices up and down. And at the end here for the power, so we're taking the value of this stuff to the power of whatever. That power defines how long we stay in that extended state. So the frequency is 2. The position diff is the value of this sine wave to the power of whatever with the frequency that we've given it at the x value, that is the time. And I'm doing 1 minus that, so we can raise the values up instead of, say, kicking them down or something. So this gives us the change in position that we need to apply to the each vertice depending on where it is on the mesh and what time it is according to the sine wave. So the sine wave, you know, from -1 to 1, we plug in a couple variables, we change it a little bit, we mush it up, and then we get this value, which is a diff. It's how far do we need to actually change the sine wave, or the vertex position. And of course, we want to change the vertex position in the normal direction. So the resulting value here is going to be the vertex normal vec, which is going to be something like 0, 1, 0, or 0.5, 0.5, 0.5, or something like that. We're going to multiply that by a smooth step of the position diff. So the position diff, because we've changed the frequency of the sine wave and because we've changed things like the amplitude of the sine wave, can get very large. So we smooth step it between 0 and 1, and that gives us a value here from 0 to 1. Anything that is over 1, so if we say went too high or anything that is below 0, so we're doing 1 minus this, which gives us lower values here, a lot more of lower values. It'll cap out or min out at 0, bottom out at 0, and it'll stay 0 through that entire time period where it would be going like way lower and then back up, which gives us kind of that staying in that bottom position a little longer. So we take that and then we multiply this effect. So we've multiplied the position difference times the vertex normal, which gives us a change in the normal direction. And we multiply the effect of that change by 0.2 because we don't actually want it to be that much. And then we add it to the current vertex position, basically. So we have a vertex position. We want to change it by some amount. That's the position that we get here. And then instead of using the vertex position for the input to things like mesh position local to world, we use the position that we just calculated. And that deals with the pressure wave over the entire sphere. So basically, we're using a sine wave offset by a number of different axes over time. And to bring this back up, you can see the pressure wave coming across, starting here, going around, starting here, going around. Now we can see the effects of these changes a little bit if we wanted to say, have this happen, a little bit more effectively. This is the buggy part where I start it up 3 times and then it doesn't quite start. So I need to figure out why that's happening. It's definitely my fault. But this is the distance change. So instead of having 0.02 here, the effect is 0.2 of the vertex or of the normal. So we're getting a much further distance, but the timing of the sine wave is still the same. So the only thing we've changed here is basically how much effect do we want this effect to have on the position of the vertex. And you can see each of the individual hexagons as these go around, which is really fun. I really like that. I think that this magic 0.2 number is fine for now, which leads us to the custom material for the fragment, which means that we are dealing now with the color of the sphere. So the simplex noise is calculated based off the world normal. So this is called swizzling. We can use any, we could do like XXZ or ZZZ or something like that. Whichever combination of letters here we want to create the vector that we want to get out. This is the world normal position of each of the vertices, or each, in this case, each of the fragments. But it's the normal position that gets passed into the simplex noise. I do a small calculation for the simplex noise, and I take that up 1 and then divide it by 2. And then we smooth step the noise from negative 1 to 3. I'm using the range negative 1 to 3 here because I want a specific range effect on the alpha value. So I'm going negative 1, so that is way below, or not way below, but it's below the actual range that the noise value is coming in at. And 3 is also higher than the noise value was coming in at. So we're kind of like doing a weird clamp here to a specific value by using smooth step. So we get a lot of sort of hexagons here that are not 0 and not 100. We get something in between. I'm sure there's a better way to do that. I just happen to be using smooth step, so I used smooth step. But yeah, that's about it. This is the base for some other experimentation that I'm doing. I am doing more sphere, more shield experimentation, which I'm super excited about. It's working out pretty well. So hopefully that will be in a new video very soon. But I'm pretty excited about this. This is like we could put something inside of this and we would be able to see that through it. This is the kind of, if you see the pressure wave going around this, we could also adjust the color, and in the next experiment that I'm working on, I actually do adjust the color based on the pressure wave. But you could imagine that the pressure wave was some projectile hitting this sphere. So it could actually act as a real shield or like an energy barrier of some kind. And as long as we can control where those points are getting hit from, we can control whether they are showing in a particular way or not. So that's super exciting. This again is just a GLTF render that I brought out of Blender. I loaded it into Bevy. I used the new material APIs in Bevy 0.8 to apply a custom material that has a custom vertex shader and a custom fragment shader. The vertex shader implements this pressure wave on all of the hexagonal faces that I've created on this sphere using an applied sine wave. And then the fragment shader handles writing out these colors based on the normal. So the color that we get back is the normal color. So if you look at all of these values, the greens and the reds and the pinks and the blues, you can actually tell what the world normal is, which is really fun because there's not many other ways to debug shaders unless you want to get into complicated debugger programs. So if you see a lot of blue, for example, you know that the Z is set, but the R and the G are not, or something like that. So super excited about this. Hope you enjoyed it. I have another super exciting shield exploration that I'm working on currently that is really awesome. So check that subscribe button if you want to see that video, because that's coming out soon. And then I'll catch you in the next one.